Welcome to Botany Insider. So in this lecture, I'll be explaining the various crosses that are included in the genetic streaming. In this lecture, we'll be dealing with the monohybrid cross and the dihybrid cross in complete detail, and we'll try to understand about the mechanism that occurs by the monohybrid cross and the dihybrid cross. So first of all, let us discuss about that what is a monohybrid cross. So monohybrid cross are the crosses that possesses a single pair of character. So the cross in which we are taking into consideration only one character at a time. So Mendel crossed the tall and the dwarf plant. He took single character, that is height, for understanding the monohybrid cross. And who was Mendel? So he was the father of genetics, and he gave various laws in order to understand the inheritance properties. And what are those laws? We'll understand about those laws in the next video. In this video, we'll understand about the various crosses. So Mendel took into consideration the height character, and the two alternatives of the height character were the tall plant and the dwarf plant. So now let's try to understand about the monohybrid cross now. So monohybrid cross, in that the parental generation is taken as, the first parent is taken as capital T, capital T. And what does this represent? So this represent that this parent is homozygous for the tall gene. What is homozygous? I have already explained about the various terms that are used in the genetics in the previous video. I'll put the links of the same in the description box. So homozygous means when both of the alleles are either of the dominant character or of the recessive character. So the first parent is homozygous dominant for the tall character, and the second parent is homozygous recessive for the dwarf character. And when we get the gametes, we will have capital T and small t as the carriers. So now, as a result of the crossing over between the tall plant and the dwarf plant, we will have capital T and small t as our F1 generation. So F1 generation means the first generation. And what is F in this? So F represents, or F stands for filial. So first filial generation, in this generation we have all the plants as tall plants. And why tall? Because even if we have got capital T and small t, we have got a heterozygous as our offspring. But in this heterozygous condition, we have the dominant trait also. So the dominant trait, because represents the tall character, hence all the offsprings would represent the capital T, that is the tall plant. So now when we would be doing the cell thing of capital T and small t, we would be having some gametes formed. So capital T and small t being the parent would form the gamete as either capital T or small t. And in the second case also same, we would be having either capital T or small t. So now we would have the various combinations in the F2 generation. That is the F2, or the second filial generation. In this, we would be having the combination of offsprings as the first one as capital T and capital T, that is a tall one. Second would be capital T and small t, that would also represent a tall one. Why? Because of the presence of one dominant allele. The third one would be capital T and small t, that is, it would also represent tall plant. And the fourth one is small t, small t. And because this small t is homozygous for the recessive character, hence it would represent the dwarf type of offspring. So these are the four offsprings that are produced in the F2 generation. So what we actually did in this particular type of cross is, so what we did is, initially we took a capital T, that is a tall plant, and it was crossed with small t, that is a dwarf plant. So now, as a result of the capital T being crossed with small t, we would have the gametes as being produced as capital T, and from this we would have the gamete as small t. So these are the gametes. So now, crossing these gametes, we would have our result as capital T and small t. So this is the F1 generation. And after the F1 generation, when we would be selfing this with the same one, that is when we self capital T small t with capital T small t, we would first have the gametes as capital T and small t from the first parent and the capital T small t from the second parent. And as a result of their selfing, we would have 4 offsprings produced in the F2 generation or the second filial generation, and the offsprings would be, the first one would be capital T capital T, the second one would be capital T and small t, third one would be capital T and small t, and the last one would be small t and small t. So now, as we know that the first, second and the third offspring would represent a tall offspring. Why? Because of the presence of either the homozygous dominant one is for the capital, and in these two, irrespective that they are heterozygous for the height character, but still they would represent the tall offspring itself. The last one is small t small t, so this would represent a dwarf plant. Why? Because we would be having all, because we have 2 alleles and both of them are homozygous for the recessive character, and the recessive character is dwarf in nature. Hence, we would be having 3 of the plants as tall and 1 of the plant as short. So we have 3 tall plant and 1 dwarf plant, and this is the phenotypic ratio of the monohybrid cross. What is a phenotype? So we have already discussed about it, that is the physical appearance, or depending upon the physical appearance of the offspring in the F2 generation, we would be having the ratio as 3:1. And when we look at the genotypic ratio in the case of monohybrid cross, so first we would be having one of them as capital T capital T is 2, we would be having 2 heterozygotes, so 2 capital T small t, and 1 would be small t, which is homozygous recessive. So the genotypic ratio would be 1:2:1. Make sure you remember about these ratios because they are very important in the complete genetics unit. Hence, you need to understand about this at this stage itself. How did we got the phenotypic ratio as 3:1? Let me explain it once more. So, because we have 3 tall and 1 dwarf plants or the offsprings produced as a result of selfing the F1 generation, we got the final ratio as 3:1 being the phenotypic ratio. Do not confuse between phenotypic and genotypic. Phenotype represents the physical appearance, and depending upon the physical appearance, we have 3 tall plant and 1 dwarf plant. And depending upon the genotypic ratio, that is the genetic makeup of the offsprings that are produced in the F2 generation, we have 1 tall plant with the homozygous dominant nature. The second one are 2 of them are tall with heterozygous nature, and the last one is homozygous recessive. So this is the genotypic ratio and this is the phenotypic ratio. I hope this much is clear to you. So now let's move ahead. So we have understood about this. Let's understand more about the monohybrid cross. So as we have just discussed about the homozygous and the heterozygous and the various ratios, so this is what is represented here. So in the genotypic ratio, we would be having 1:2:1, and the phenotypic ratio is 3:1. How did we got this? I have explained you in the same manner. So now let's understand about the dihybrid cross. Till now we understood about the monohybrid cross, and now we'll explain about the dihybrid cross. So in monohybrid cross, we took into consideration only one of the character, and in case of dihybrid cross, we will be taking 2 of the characters into consideration. So the hybrids that possesses 2 pairs of characters is what is included in the dihybrid cross, and the 2 colors or the 2 characters that we are taking into consideration are, the first one is the color of the seed and the cotyledons, that is yellow and green, and yellow is a dominant trait and the green one is a recessive trait. the second character that is taken into consideration is the form of the right pods. So now let's try and understand about the dihybrid cross. So this is how a dihybrid cross actually looks like. So what we are doing in dihybrid cross is that first we are taking into consideration two characters. So what are the two characters that we have taken? The first one is the color of the pod, and the second one is the shape of the pod or the form of the pod. And we have to remember that yellow and round are dominant characters, and green and wrinkled are the recessive characters. Yellow, that is the color, is represented by the Y gene, and the form is represented by the R gene. So we have to remember that the color is yellow or green, and because yellow is dominant, so dominant would be represented by capital Y, capital Y, and green would be represented by small y, small y. The second one is the form of the right pod, which is either round or wrinkled. So round is represented by R and wrinkled is represented by small r, which is a recessive character. So this is the first thing that you have to remember. Now first we would be making out the gametes from the parents. So we have the parents as capital Y, capital Y, capital R, capital R. So the first parent is yellow and round in character. We are taking two characters in consideration. So the two characters are yellow and round. In the second case, that is the second parent is green and wrinkled, that is small y and small r, and when we have the gametes from these parents, we would be having the first gamete from the parent 1 as capital Y and capital R, and from the second parent we would be having small y and small r. So these are the two gametes formed, and in the F1 generation we would be having the final offspring produced as the capital Y, small y, capital R and small r, because of the combination of these two, and as a result we would be having the offspring having the characteristics of yellow and round. Why? Because they are heterozygotes, but the dominant character is present, hence the dominant character would be represented. So we would have yellow and round being shown in the F1 generation. And after the F1 generation, we would be selfing the offspring that is produced with its same variety. So now what we would be doing is that we would be selfing out the capital Y, capital R, small r with the same one, that is capital Y, capital R and small r. So now we would be having the gametes formed as a result of their crosses. So the various gametes possible are, from this parent we would be having 4 gametes. The first one would be capital Y, capital R, second one would be capital Y, small r, third one would be small y, capital R, and the fourth one would be small y, small r. So these are the 4 characters, and in the second case the same gametes would be formed, that is capital Y, capital R, second one would be capital Y, small r, third one is small y, capital R, and the fourth one is small y, small r. So now we have to make the offspring out of these combinations. So how we would be making it? Because it is not possible to have made the cross the way we made in the monohybrid cross. Hence we use Punnett square for the same case. So how to make a Punnett square? So Punnett square is made by calculating or by writing down the various gametes in the horizontal and vertical manner, and then trying to write down all of the offsprings. So let's try the same. So we have from the first parent as these 4 gametes. So we would be making a Punnett square. So consider, this is the Punnett square that we would be making. So this is the Punnett square. So on one side we have the 4 gametes as capital Y, capital R, second one would be capital Y, small r, third one is small y, capital R, and the fourth one is small y, small r. In the same way, we have from the other parent as capital Y, capital R, capital Y, small r, third one is small y, capital R, and the fourth one is small y, small r. So now what you have to do is you have to write the result of these crosses. How? Let me try to show you with the first one. So in the first box, we would be having the combination of this and this. So we would have capital Y, capital R, capital Y, capital R. In the second one, we would be having capital Y, capital R, small r. In the third case, we would be having capital Y, small y, capital R. In the fourth one, capital Y, capital R, small r. So we have to continue this process for all of the combinations. And as a result of this, we would be having the Punnett square as this form. So this is what we have just made. On one side, we have written the gametes from the parent first, and from the second one, I have written the gametes from the parent second. And these parents are from the F1 generation. And as a result of that, we have these 16 of the offsprings produced with the following characteristic. So let's try to understand that which of the characteristic is formed. In the first case, we have capital Y, capital R, capital R. So this would be yellow and round in shape. Why yellow? Because it is homozygous for capital Y and it is homozygous for the round shape also. Hence, it would be round and yellow. In the same way, we would be having 9 round and yellow of the same offsprings produced. Hence, 9 would be round and yellow. 3 would be round and green. So, we have 1, 2 and 3. Why? Because they are homozygous recessive. Because they are homozygous recessive for the color, but they are homozygous or heterozygous dominant for the shape. 3 of them are round and green. In the same way, we have 3 of them as wrinkled and yellow, and the final one is wrinkled and green, which is only 1 in nature. Why? Because this is the only offspring which is homozygous recessive for both of the character. Hence, we have 1 of them as homozygous recessive for both character. And when we look at the phenotypic ratio, so we got the final answer as the 9:3:3:1. How did we get this? So we have just understood the same. 9 of them are round and yellow. 3 of them are round and green. The other 3 are wrinkled and yellow. And the final one, which is only 1 in nature, that is wrinkled and green in nature. So these are the 16 offsprings that are produced. So now we have the phenotypic ratio as 9:3:3:1. And how do we calculate the genotypic ratio? So we have either two ways. The first way is to remember the complete long list, and the list is 1:2:1:2:2:4:2:1:2:2:1. So this is very difficult to remember if you do not know that how did I write it. So let me explain you that how do we have to find out the genotypic and the phenotypic ratio. All you need is that you need to remember the ratios of the phenotype and the genotype in the case of monohybrid cross. As we have just discussed that in the monohybrid cross, the phenotypic ratio is 3:1 and the genotypic ratio is 1:2:1. So this is the basic ratio for the monohybrid cross. So for finding out the phenotypic or the genotypic ratio for the dihybrid or the trihybrid or any of the cross that you are focusing upon, what you have to do is use the formula. For phenotypic ratio, use the formula of 3:1 to the power n, and n is the number of the characters that you are taking into consideration. And if you want to find the genotypic ratio, same 1:2:1 to the power n, and here also n represents the number of the characters that you are taking into consideration. For example, you are taking into consideration 2 characters in case of dihybrid cross. So just write down 3:1 to the power n, and here n represents 2. So write down 3:1 to the power 2. So how would you solve it? It would be 3:1 multiplied by 3:1. So just multiply 3 with both of them and then 1 with both of them. So we get the answer as 3 into 3 we get 9, 3 into 1 we get 3, 1 into 3 is 3, and 1 into 1 is 1. So we have the ratio of the phenotype in case of dihybrid cross as 9:3:3:1, which is the ratio that we have got by the help of the experiment that we just understood. So let's calculate the genotypic ratio also. So the genotypic ratio is 1:2:1 to the power 2. Why? Because we have just understood the same, and here two characters are taken into consideration, hence 2 is taken in the power. So just calculate it same way. So 1:2:1 to the power or multiplied by 1:2:1. So we have the final answer as multiply 1 with all of the 3. So we have 1:2:1 multiply 2 with all of the 3. We have 2:4:2 and then again repeat the same step, multiply 1 with all of them. So we have 1:2:1. So this is the genotypic ratio for the F2 generation. As I have just told you that this is the genotypic ratio. So it is very easy to remember. All you need to understand is that in monohybrid cross, we have 3:1 as our phenotypic ratio and 1:2:1 as our genotypic ratio. And whenever in the examination or anywhere else you need to find out the ratios depending upon the question, you can use this formula and find out the ratio without even having to remember the very large ratio size. So with this, we're done with this particular lecture in which we discussed about the various type of crosses. I hope this video was helpful for you, and if you like this video, please do like, share it with your friends, and please subscribe to my channel. I'll be coming up very soon with more informative videos. So thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you soon. Bye.